Good evening and welcome to Look North. Our top story tonight. A boy pleads not guilty to murdering 15-year-old Alfie Lewis, who was stabbed to death in Leeds last month. We'll have the latest from Leeds Crown Court also tonight. Residents in parts of Sheffield have been demonstrating as they say they're going weeks without any post.
Royal Mail's only got one job to do. It's clearly failing at that job now.
Super Cynthia from Rotherham, who spent decades helping others, is preparing to receive an MBE from the King. Spreading Christmas cheer, the deaf children signing their favourite festive tunes for shoppers in Doncaster.
And it was very soggy underfoot in Wickersley this morning. More rain on the way through the weekend, wet and windy conditions. I'll be back later in the programme with a full forecast.
Hello and thank you for joining us this Friday evening. A 14-year-old boy has denied murdering a teenager who was fatally stabbed in Leeds last month. Alfie Lewis was attacked near a primary school in Horsforth on the 7th of November. He died later in hospital. Today, a boy who can't be named for legal reasons appeared at Leeds Crown Court and pleaded not guilty to his murder. Well, our reporter Corin Wheatley was in court for us. Corin, what happened during the hearing?
Thanks, Amanda. Well, a 14-year-old boy appeared at Leeds Crown Court today to face two charges. Firstly, murdering Alfie Lewis on the 7th of November in Horsforth. The other charge, having an offensive weapon, specifically a kitchen knife, in Horsforth on that same date. Now, the boy, who can't be named due to his age, pleaded not guilty to murdering Alfie. He admitted the charge relating to the knife. He only spoke during the hearing, which lasted for about 40 minutes or so, to confirm his identity and to enter those pleas. He'd already been remanded into youth detention accommodation at an earlier date, and he's going to stay there until his trial next year.
And Corin, just remind us of the circumstances around Alfie's death.
Well, Alfie Lewis was 15 years old. He was stabbed just before 3 p.m. on the 7th of November in Horsforth, and he died later from his injuries in hospital. His funeral was held a week ago, where his family and hundreds of his friends gathered at a bench where he was known to spend some of his time, and followed a funeral procession through Horsforth to St Margaret's Church for a service. And over the weeks since his death, lots of flowers, tributes, mementos have been piled up at that bench where he was known to spend his time. The trial is scheduled to start on the 22nd of April next year, and it's expected to last about 3 weeks.
Corin, thank you. Next tonight, you're supposed to have your post delivered 6 days a week, but for half a year now, residents in the S8 postcode in South Sheffield say they're still waiting several days or even weeks before receiving mail. A demo has been taking place outside the Woodseat sorting office in support of postal workers but against senior management. Royal Mail is blaming higher than usual levels of sickness absence and the number of vacancies. Here's Mark Ansell.
Save our post! Save our posties! Save our post!
They want to send Royal Mail bosses a clear message. They're fed up of not receiving their post.
Royal Mail's only got one job to do. It's clearly failing at that job now. Not only that, but it's alienating the British public, causing distress and harm to its own workforce, and in front of our eyes, dismantling one of the country's most beloved and oldest institutions.
Fiona is a new mother of twin baby girls. She ordered their birth certificates first class tracked delivery a month ago, but they've still not arrived, meaning she cannot order their passports to visit her partner's family overseas or register for child benefit.
We used to have John, our postie, who was always dressing up, raising money, walking the streets of S8. And we don't have that consistency anymore. We don't have happy staff down there. We don't have posties that are enjoying their work or kind of being looked after. I think my message to them would be that the cuts that they're making to their services are just having a huge detrimental impact on not only their staff, but the communities that they're supposed to be serving.
At the other side of the S8 postcode, it's another day with no post. Farmer Stephen says it's having a big impact on his business.
We now can't order anything for the business through the Royal Mail. Even special delivery for seamen, we're having that come by courier. We had some bottles of penicillin that were coming for the pigs. They didn't arrive for 4 days. We ordered it and it came by courier, and that still arrived before the post office delivery did. So for animal welfare and for sales and things, and also for the butchery side of the business, any checks get lost in the post for a week.
In a statement, Royal Mail says, we are making deliveries 6 days a week, with the vast majority of addresses receiving their mail on time. However, there have, at times, been delays that have been caused by higher than usual levels of sickness absence and a number of vacancies. Mark Ansell, BBC Look North, Woodseats in Sheffield.
Yeah, let's hope there's more improvements to come. Now you're watching Friday's Look North, still to come on tonight's programme.
We're on a night out with a difference. The music's on, the drinks are flowing, but there's one thing missing. Find out what it is later in the programme. Cheers.
But first, a football hooligan who killed a rival fan in an attack outside a Sheffield pub has been jailed for 10 years. Liam Jones, who's 20, pleaded guilty to killing Sheffield Wednesday supporter Richard Wheeler. He died 10 days after the attack near the Bessemer pub in July. Police are not doing enough to tackle grooming gangs who abuse children, according to a report by the police watchdog released today. The report says Rotherham is an area of particular consideration. His Majesty's Inspectorate of Constabulary says there have been some areas of improvement, but overall progress has been too slow and there isn't enough reliable information about the problem. The two ringleaders of a Bradford-based organised crime gang have been jailed for selling heroin and crack cocaine in Harrogate. Kyle Sterling and Lee Bavin, who are both 30, have been given sentences totalling 17 years. Leeds Crown Court heard how police managed to infiltrate their phone network to stop them advertising drugs for sale. Now, police are going to increase patrols around a golf club in Leeds that's been repeatedly targeted by vandals. Gotts Park Golf Club in Armley has been hit by antisocial behaviour several times over the past 2 years, including last weekend, when West Yorkshire Police says significant damage was caused by off-road bikers. The club is mainly run by volunteers who say it may have to close if the vandalism continues. What a shame. Now, Yorkshire could see a big increase in the number of battery energy storage systems being built as the country switches over to renewables. These sites collect energy as it's produced from wind farms and solar panels and store it for when it's needed. There are currently 100 locations in the region earmarked as potential battery storage plants, but not everyone's in favour of them. Here's our business correspondent, Spencer Stokes.
This is the UK's second largest battery energy storage system at Cottingham in East Yorkshire. Giant Tesla car batteries soaking up excess electricity from wind turbines and solar panels and then releasing it back into the grid at times of high demand.
As we make the switch to renewables, it's likely we'll need more energy storage. And that means big, high-powered batteries close to power lines and substations.
This battery energy storage system is run by Yorkshire-based Harmony, who operate at 11 sites across the UK. They're predicting a big rise in the numbers of batteries and battery plants.
We need much, much more. So we need something like 10 times the amount we have today within the next 10 years. And the reason is, if we didn't have that, we wouldn't be able to accelerate the growth in renewable energy. You'd then need to switch off wind farms, which we're currently actually doing, because we don't have sufficient energy storage on the network to take that surplus power, which is crazy and creates more expense in the system. So the more energy storage we can build out, the more it'll help reduce consumer pricing.
In Yorkshire, there are currently 12 proposed battery storage sites and a further 100 potential locations. This one at Ledston near Leeds has just been rejected by planners, but a proposal for Heath near Wakefield awaits a decision. Meanwhile, at Carlton, between Leeds and Wakefield, campaigners have spent the last 9 months fighting a four-acre development that would hand farmland over to battery storage.
This is the Rhubarb Triangle. We grow rhubarb here. There was rhubarb growing in the field. This is a fairly rural village. There's plenty of other places they could put it that's not right next to a beck, right next to nature, and close to a primary school.
It's not just the loss of farmland that concerns campaigners. Fears about fires are voiced after a blaze at a plant in Liverpool. But Harmony Energy say the risk is minute.
So in the UK, there's been one single incident on a completely different technology. And we all have mobile phones, we all have laptops, a lot of electric vehicles. They are obviously safe. We're very passionate about safety. It's one of our core values. And we would encourage everyone to come and look at our sites that's concerned about safety.
Not all battery energy storage systems will be as big as this one, but we are likely to see growing numbers of sites where power firms want to install batteries so that wind and solar energy can be stored for future use. Spencer Stokes, BBC Look North, Cottingham.
Next tonight, a Scarborough charity is seeking a new home as it struggles to house thousands of donated exhibits. The Maritime Heritage Centre is bursting at the seams with treasures of the town's past, so now it's appealing for help in setting up in new and larger premises. Carla Fowler has been to visit one very full Aladdin's Cave of local history.
All hands on deck. The Maritime Heritage Centre needs help. It's a volunteer-run charity dedicated to preserving Scarborough's unique history. But it's now bursting at the seams of its modest home. Set up in 2009, it's grown and grown. Artifacts are brought in weekly by the public, along with the secret histories they contain. All are carefully logged and preserved, but can sadly no longer be displayed.
We just haven't got the room. We've got a warehouse that's full. Downstairs is full, the archive room is full, and this place, we need to display things in this area, but we haven't got the room. There's lots more we'd like to display, and we just can't do it.
We are basically a small shop down on Eastborough, and we would like at least three or four times the size of the exhibition space. And the biggest problem really is school groups. We'd love to have school groups in which are 30 children at a time, and we just don't have the space for that. So we think we can deliver a much better service to the community and to the visitors of Scarborough and the locals if we had a larger space.
Currently, the volunteers go into schools and take exhibits along with them, but some are too big or too precious to move, like this 19th century ship's medicine chest, complete with gruesome treatments and a tiny ship's Bible for when they don't work.
It's so important because Scarborough has had maritime interests for centuries now, and so much of what has been held by individuals in the town is disappearing fast. As people clear out their homes and families depart from the maritime industry, things get destroyed. We're trying to maintain a museum, if you like, of all these artefacts for the future.
To continue its important work, the Heritage Centre needs help and public support for a new building. It's hoped one day all the hidden treasures will be back on display in the town where they belong. Carla Fowler, BBC Look North, Scarborough.
Oh yes, some wonderful treasures there. Now sport, and Leeds Rhinos legend Kevin Sinfield has smashed his fundraising target after running seven ultramarathons in the last 7 days. The gruelling challenge ended in London last night, raising money for people affected by motor neurone disease, inspired by his friend and former teammate Rob Burrow, who was diagnosed in 2019. Kevin's online fundraiser passed the target of £777,777 this morning. Absolutely incredible. And in rugby league, there's been a significant new investment in the Castleford Tigers. Their new director, Martin Jepson, says he's put a seven-figure sum into the club. Jepson is a property businessman and lifelong Tigers fan. He says the priority is to secure Castleford's place in Super League for the long term. Now, they say laughter is the best medicine, and that's certainly what one surgeon from Sheffield thinks. Gareth Honeybone works at the Sheffield Royal Hallamshire Hospital. Now, last year he was diagnosed with bile duct cancer, which is a type of liver cancer. In Yorkshire, just 21% of this type of cancer are diagnosed in the early stages, where it is more treatable. Well, now Gareth has turned his experience into a stand-up comedy show to raise awareness. And earlier I spoke to him, and I began by asking how he's doing.
It has been a really tough year, but I was given the all clear in September. Since then, I've just been enjoying myself and looking forward to Christmas.
And tell me a little bit about this stand-up comedy. It's quite a far cry, isn't it, from your day job as a trainee surgeon?
Yeah, they are very different things. Obviously, the surgery and what I'm trained to do is very hard work and takes a lot of out of you, so it's good to have something to switch off. And so I enjoy watching comedy, and I'm going to try and enjoy performing it as well.
And I guess they're both kind of performances, aren't they?
Yeah, you have to put a bit of a show on to patients if they're a bit anxious. You have to play the character of the training surgeon and put them at ease. Also, you try and be yourself in both ways. But yeah, both different, but both really enjoyable things.
And do you use the material from the people that you've met and the situations you've been in? Are these real-life situations that you've kind of put a funny spin on?
So I don't want to talk about any patients or anything. All the stuff I talk about is all personal to myself. I try and keep the two things separate. I wouldn't want to joke about patient stories. I want to joke about my own stories. I think I've lived enough that I've got a lot of funny things to talk about myself.
And a lot of people would say cancer isn't really something that you can laugh about. How do you find the humour in it?
So having experienced it, there's lots of things that happen. There's quite a lot of medical things that are actually quite funny, just catheters, surgery, that sort of thing. When you've experienced it, you think, looking back, it's actually quite funny. And humour is the best way of dealing with it.
And you're hoping to raise lots of money, aren't you? Just tell me about that.
Yeah, so the charity I'm raising for is called AMMF, which is the UK's only cholangiocarcinoma charity, which is cancer I had. Cholangiocarcinoma is bile duct cancer, a really rare cancer. There's not too much research for it. So it'd be really good to raise as much money and just a profile of this little charity that does a lot of really good work.
And how are you feeling about Sunday?
Feeling a little bit nervous. I did do a little practice gig yesterday that went really well, so that's giving me more confidence that Sunday's going to go better.
Well, Gareth, I'm sure you'll impress the audience. Best of luck for this weekend.
Thank you.
Yes, I'm sure it'll be great. Now, it's just 2 weeks, can you believe, until Christmas, and the party season is in full swing. But did you know more and more of us are giving up the booze in favour of a sober night out? And now there are special events being put on to cater for this growing demand. We sent Ollie Constable to tell the pub a bit more about it.
Friday night in the pub, Amanda, you do know how to spoil us. Well, we're here at the Forum in Sheffield, gate crashing a Christmas do with the Sheffield Children's Hospital. Yay! Hey! We definitely haven't practiced that. Christmas do's are all about food, drink and crackers as well. Well, it is the season for Christmas do's, and did you know a lot more of us are doing them sober? Well, we went to a very special event in Leeds last night where they did just that.
This may look like a normal night out, but there's one big difference. Everyone here is stone cold sober. Every drink is alcohol free, from your beers to mocktails to that not so cheeky rum and coke.
Oh, it's nice.
This bar wouldn't normally open until 10 p.m, but this evening it's hosting this sober night out as a trial.
We want people to be able to enjoy events and party, but not feel like if they don't drink that they can't be involved in it. So that's the idea for us, to really open up our doors to everybody.
And it's not about being teetotal. It's showcasing the range of drinks on offer and how you can still have a good time without getting hammered.
We've been on nights out in Leeds. Like, we went out, there was about 30 of us not long ago, and we went out to a bar and we had a great time, because there was alcohol-free drinks.
The alcohol-free drinks I've tried today, they're lovely, and you can't tell the difference, and I like them better.
You're still having a good time with your mates?
Yeah, I'm still having a brilliant time. Yeah.
I've gone out clubbing till like 2 in the morning with my mates. I've had Heineken Zero and things like that, so a lot of the bars will sell, you know, beers like that, which you can have, and you feel like you're still having a drink with people, but you don't have the regret the next day, I guess.
And it's a project called No Regrets which has put on this alternative Christmas do. They say a quarter of young people in Leeds are concerned about their drinking and hope more events like this normalise sober nights out.
If you don't want to drink, that's absolutely fine, it's accepted. Reducing that stigma about, you know, reasons that people might not want to drink. You can choose not to drink and have a good time, just like you can also find that balance. You might want to just have a couple and stop there.
Well, as more young people decide to change their drinking habits and cut back on the booze, maybe more bars will opt for a dry night out.
I'll tell you what, this food looks pretty good as well. They had a great time last night, and so are we tonight as well. Christmas do's are all about, they're not all about drinking, of course. It's about the food, it's about the social aspect, and it's also about dressing up as well. I thought I'd try and make the effort. Here we go, my Christmas jumper. What do you think of that? Yeah, it's a bit disappointing, isn't it? I did it on my dinner break, Amanda, but it's all about making the effort, remember? Making the effort.
Ollie, I am absolutely loving it. More is more in my book. Well done. Love it. Is that Rudolph? Wonderful. Now, shoppers in Doncaster were in for a treat earlier today as a group of young people took to the streets to sing and sign along to their favourite festive tunes. The children from Doncaster School for the Deaf and Plover School in South Yorkshire performed Christmas songs in British Sign Language at the Lakeside Village shopping outlet. Let's see them in action.
Doncaster School for the Deaf and Plover School are here today. Doncaster School for the Deaf normally come every year. They just sign the Christmas songs for us and the customers, collect some donations, and it just starts our Christmas off really, gets us all ready.
Oh, they love coming here because they've been practising signing for a long time now. And we are ready for the big day today. We're really excited because there's a fantastic atmosphere and there's lots of hearing people who are watching as well. What a nice way to
spend the year. It gives the children a chance to teach some members of the public some signs for the songs, because some of them, like We Wish You a Merry Christmas, is really easy to pick up. So, yeah, they enjoy teaching their own language and culture to anybody who wants to learn, really.
Would you like Father Christmas to bring you?
I like cupcakes, sweets, Mickey Mouse clothes, Mickey Mouse bunny.
Any favourite song?
Santa Claus is coming to town.
Brilliant. Hey, put it there, Darius.
Absolutely fantastic. Now, a beloved community volunteer in Rotherham says news of her MBE has caused quite a stir. 84-year-old Cynthia Shaw has spent decades volunteering as a magistrate, parish councillor, governor and charity fundraiser. Cynthia's MBE was revealed in the New Year's Honours List last Christmas, and she'll be presented with the award by King Charles, no less, next week.
And it said, Madam, you should arrive at the castle between the hours of 9:45 and 10:15. I mean, it's awe-inspiring, really.
It's not every day you get a letter from the King, but 84-year-old Cynthia has been chosen to receive an MBE for a lifetime of helping others.
I feel humbled, to be honest. I feel, do I deserve it? There surely are other people that have worked perhaps longer than I have or done more than I have.
Cynthia grew up in South Yorkshire. Her dad was a coal miner and she was always taught a strong work ethic.
What strikes me more than anything is what my parents would have thought. My dad would have been absolutely amazed, he really would. And it's caused quite a stir.
Thank you.
And no more so than at the village hall, which she saved from ruin after raising thousands of pounds to preserve it.
She never stops. She deserves at least an MBE. Tonight, when most people are at home taking it easy, she'll be taking calls from parishioners. She just never stops. She's $1 million, and I'm proud that she calls me friend.
We're so proud of her in Wentworth WI. She's an absolute legend in the area. Everybody knows Cynthia, and she's wonderful.
Cynthia's diary is as busy as ever, but she has made room to meet the King next week.
Various people have said things like, does the King know what he's letting himself in for? Will you ask him for some money? Because I ask everybody for money, for the mission, of course.
Always thinking about the next project, but there is just time to work on that curtsy.
Oh, congratulations, Cynthia. And I can confirm that Cynthia makes the best date and walnut cake in the land.
Now, all right for some.
Now on to the weather. Dare I throw to you after last Friday?
I'm not really sure. Shall I just come and sit down there now?
Yeah, we had no graphics. Yes. I don't know if our regular viewers will remember that.
Fingers crossed for better luck this week.
Be fine.
Right, this is a picture for you, Amanda. I'm not sure what that cheeky little elf is doing there, but the doggy picture was for you, Amanda.
Oh, lovely.
A muddy but a misty start to the day in Aberford this morning. And the second picture, a flooded river ooze through the middle of York there. And we have got actually quite a lot of rain in the forecast over the next few days. A very unsettled weekend. Keep your pictures coming in to the Weather Watchers page. We're also on social media at Keely Donovan on X and Keely.Donovan on Twitter. So yes, the weekend is dominated by low pressure. We're looking at wet and windy conditions through tomorrow, particularly wet through the morning, particularly windy, I think, through the afternoon, with the Met Office warning that those gusts could touch gale force through the afternoon. Low pressure dominating. We've got one system going through on Saturday, another system going through on Sunday after a dry start. A ridge of high pressure for Monday, settle things down for a time, but we have got another area of low pressure, so rain again into Tuesday. And we have had some rain today as well. It crept onto the Pennines where it stayed for most of the morning, but through this afternoon it has spread eastwards. At times there've still been some breaks in it, and it's still a little bit damp out there in places at the moment. I think what we'll find over the next few hours, it'll become dry, and it does look like a dry night with some clear spells as well. And then towards the end of the night, this rain starts to show its hand, pushing in from the west and the south. Not before temperatures drop back to around 5 or 6 degrees. The breeze will freshen overnight as well. Let's have a look at those tide times in Scarborough at 1:02 and then again at 1:38 in the afternoon. So we'll start the day on a wet note, that rain spreading up from the south. It'll be heavy and persistent at times through the morning, tending to ease for the afternoon before it returns again from the west tomorrow evening. But it will be a windy afternoon with the risk of gales. And temperatures tomorrow on the mild side. A real change from last weekend's cold, frosty conditions. We'll get up to around 10 or 11 degrees. So we'll start the day on Sunday on a dry note, but rain will spread in from the west once again. Quite short-lived on Sunday, I think. It should brighten up through the afternoon with some sunshine developing. And then on Monday, a ridge of high pressure settles things down, so we should get away after a damp start with some dry conditions on Monday. It turns more unsettled again for the middle of the week, but there's some indications that high pressure could develop again towards the end of next week. Amanda, we got there.
So we either get a soggy dog walk in the morning tomorrow or blown sideways in the afternoon.
Absolutely, take your pick.
Oh, I can't wait.
You're spoiled for choice.
Wonderful. Thank you very much, Keely. That is it from us. Have a lovely weekend and we'll see you again very soon. Goodbye.